So, welcome everybody. Welcome to today's colloquium. We're very fortunate to have John Dudley here, who will tell us about the unexpected ultrafast extreme light, the Nobel Prize, and the history of nonlinear science, and everything else. Before we start, and before I introduce John, I would like to tell you a little bit about how today is going to go. So I will spend a few words on John and his achievements, and then he will give his seminar. Then there will be questions. This sounds pretty normal so far, right? Then there will be questions. And then all of us, except for the diploma students and John, are going to go outside and drink and eat and enjoy ourselves. The new diploma students, and John, will be here talking about physics, life. Any question that they like to ask John, he's obliged to answer. So the new diploma students, where are you, please? Yeah, these guys. They're all going to stay here and drill you after the colloquium. So ask him anything. He's open to everything. So his life, physics, whatever you like. Okay? So that's the procedure. All right. Now let me start with the official stuff. So as I said, I'd like to welcome you all, including those people who are watching us through live streaming today. And now I'd like to say something about John. John is actually a New Zealander, which means that I cannot discuss cricket nor rugby with him, which is really annoying. But in any case, he got his PhD from the University of Auckland in New Zealand in 1987, and he worked at the University of St. Andrews and the University of Auckland before his appointment in 2000 as professor at the University of Franche-Comté, I believe, in France. His research combines both theory and experiment in optical physics, and he has made particular contributions in the fields of ultrafast optics, appropriate for today's colloquium, supercontinuum generation, and the science of rogue waves. I don't know what a rogue wave is, so I'd like to find out. In addition to his research, he's committed to education and the public communication of science. He has received a number of distinctions for his efforts in education and research, most recently the 2019 SPI Harold E. Edgerton Award, recognizing his contributions to ultrafast measurements in nonlinear fiber optics. For those of you who think SPI is a front for CIA, it's not. It's one of the biggest optic societies in the world. It's one of the ones which participates in the Winter College that we have here every year in February. John has served as the president of the European Physical Society for a two-year term from April 2013, to March 2015, and he has worked with UNESCO and the ICTP since 2011 in organizing and chairing the International Year of Light in 2015. He's also helped to organize the International Day of Light that took place for the first time in 2018, and I trust he will tell us more about the upcoming International Days of Light in his colloquium. I should say that the International Year of Light in 2015 was jointly managed from UNESCO headquarters in Paris and ICTP here with our Jonia Mella, who and they together were the global coordinators working with several ICTP staff running the website and organizing the opening ceremony in Paris and helping to coordinate and track over 13,000 events worldwide. Held in more than 140 countries. For that, thanks go in particular to Vivian Zaccaria, Eleonora Crotta, and Alessandra Ricci for all of their support here at the ICTP. I think they should be recognized, as should Joe and John for all the efforts that they made to make that one of the best science, only science, days ever. So, as I said, our new diploma students are supposed to stay behind at the end of the talk to interact with John privately. So, with that, welcome.
Great, thank you very much for the intro, and thanks to Joe and ICTP and the director for giving me the chance to come here and speak to you on this topic, which I hope you'll find as interesting as me. I discovered a lot of this history in thinking about the award of the 2018 Nobel Prize, which was, I think, 4 weeks today, exactly. It's the first Tuesday of October. Every year is the award of the Nobel Prize in Physics. So watch out next year. Make sure you're not doing anything on the first Tuesday of October and keep your mobile phones on. So this is an outline of the talk. It's just got some words that you may not expect to see in an ordinary physics seminar. So this is a once-over, very quick survey of lots of topics. Some of the slides will just flash up. Some of them we'll talk about in more detail. But hopefully, we'll learn a few things about ultrafast light and the Nobel Prize itself that we didn't know before. Now, I've never given this talk before, so it's prepared just for you. So let's see how it goes. I don't really know if it will all fit, but let's see. So this is the starting point. Tuesday in October, a month ago, the Nobel Prize in Physics was announced in Stockholm for groundbreaking inventions in the field of laser physics. So one half of the prize went to a scientist called Arthur Ashkin for the optical tweezers and their application in biology, and the other half was shared between two people, so they get a quarter each, to Gerard Mourou and Donna Strickland for their method of generating high-intensity ultra-short optical pulses. So Gerard Mourou is a UNESCO friend and collaborator for a long time. He composed an anthem of music for the opening ceremony of the International Year of Light. And he spoke on this topic on January 19th, 2015 at UNESCO headquarters. Donna Strickland has been president of the Optical Society of America. So what I like about the prize to Mourou and Strickland is that it doesn't just recognize their fantastic science, but somehow, unconsciously or otherwise, it acknowledges the fact that they are committed more broadly to the field of optical science and physics and the community in general. Now, if you go back through history, you find that light, lasers, spectroscopy, all the applications of the above have been recognized extremely frequently in the award of the Nobel Prize. Even Albert Einstein got the Nobel Prize for the photoelectric effect, although there was quite a choice they could have made amongst his many contributions to statistical mechanics, cosmology, Hamiltonian chaos, and so forth. They really had to choose one, and they chose light. There have been Nobel Prizes in chemistry and medicine, also associated with the use of lasers and light in different therapies. Now, one person who didn't get the Nobel Prize was Maxwell, because the Nobel Prize did not exist at the time that Maxwell did his work, although if it did, I'm sure he would have got it. Now, the modern physical understanding of light begins with James Clerk Maxwell, and without his unification of electricity, magnetism, and this number C, which describes the speed of propagation of an electromagnetic wave, we wouldn't have the modern theory of electromagnetic light, of electromagnetic radiation, without which our telephones wouldn't work. Now, our telephones also wouldn't work without quantum mechanics. And for quantum mechanics, we have to go back to Max Planck. Now, this is a story that you've all heard at undergraduate physics, that the spectrum of a black body was measured, And it was found that whilst classical theory could explain it in the infrared, it couldn't explain the spectrum in the ultraviolet, and you had this Rayleigh Jeans ultraviolet catastrophe, and Planck had to go around and quantize the field, and just like magic, quantum mechanics was born. What people don't recognize, and what I've seen written in English for the first time only this month in the Europhysics News article, is that the origin of quantum mechanics has its genesis in the very banal question relating to a choice of lighting for the city of Berlin. The early years of the 20th century were the time when cities worldwide were deciding, do we replace our gas lamps with this new thing called electricity? And like everywhere, and especially in Germany, efficiency is the most important thing. So they wanted to understand how much light could they get per mark? What was the best light source they could have, like we do today when we're thinking about fluorescent lights or LEDs in our homes or buildings? They had the same preoccupation. And it was that very practical question which motivated them to measure the spectra of light. And that was Kirchhoff, Kirchhoff was behind those measurements, and Wien and many others. But it's a fascinating thing how an industry question motivated the measurements that inspired Planck to think about the spectra of radiation. And I think that's a wonderful thing, right? We put quantum mechanics on a pedestal as some kind of magic theory that emerged from the intellectual pursuit of a few German scientists, right? But actually, it was a bit more banal than that, right? Comes down to more practical things. Now, Einstein in 1917 extended that theory to develop the theory of stimulated emission, quantum electronics, and so forth. 1917 was a busy year for Einstein. He also solved the field equations for cosmology and discovered quantum chaos in Hamiltonian systems. So there you are, great man. Coherent light didn't exist until a few decades later, when the maser was invented in 1965, the maser being a microwave version of the laser, amplified radiation by stimulated emission of radiation. The maser was invented by Charles Townes and Jim Gordon, and the laser was first worked in an industry laboratory by Ted Maiman in 1960. Now, the 1964 Nobel Prize went to Charles Townes for the laser, as well as two Russians, Vasov and Prokhorov, who shared the Nobel Prize for quantum electronics, which led to the construction of oscillators and amplifiers based on the maser laser principle. Interestingly, half the prize went to an American and half went to two Russians. I'm not sure what was going on there. I can imagine the debates that go on. Who didn't win the Nobel Prize? Okay, the student who actually got the maser to work, Jim Gordon, did not win the Nobel Prize. Charles Townes was a theorist. Ted Maiman, who got the first laser to work in Hughes Research Laboratory, he also didn't get the Nobel Prize, even though he went against the, or maybe because he went against the wisdom of the time that required a four-level system with all its elegance to create the first laser. He made it pragmatically just by pumping a three-level system as hard as he could, intuiting that it would work if you hit it hard enough. Gordon Gould created the laser acronym. Interesting story, he holds the patents for the laser and became very rich out of it. He's a name, not a name that you hear very often. He spoke a great deal to Charles Townes when he was a student at Columbia, and got his musings, which were original on the subject, notarized by a notary public in the United States to protect his patent priority. So there's lots of interesting things about this. Now, 16th of May was the day when Ted Maiman first got the laser to work, and it was that which was selected by UNESCO as the date for a permanent celebration of the science of light and the applications of light and the culture of light through its International Day of Light. And this is Maimon's lab book with the rather hard to read May 16, 1960, written on there. Now, the International Day of Light will be celebrated here next year through a conference called Illuminating Education, and I take the blame for that pun. Michael Berry, who's an ICTP Distinguished Fellow, will be speaking on light and nature and other topics, and we will have travel grants available for attendees from developing countries. So keep an eye on this website, lightday.org. It's not especially difficult to remember. And as soon as the possibility to register for this event takes place, jump at the chance because it will be a lot of fun. So that's the Day of Light. Now, the laser was the 16th of May. We tend to forget about its precursor, which was the microwave maser. But the maser was very important for science because the maser is a microwave amplifier. And amongst the predictions of the existence of the Big Bang was the presence of a microwave background radiation associated essentially with the cooling of the universe. So we go back to a black body spectrum again, but in the context of cosmology, which I find is interesting. And this instrument, the maser, was used as an amplifier, was the only low noise radio frequency amplifier that existed that allowed you to unambiguously say that that noise coming from the sky had a cosmic origin. So I find it fascinating that from quantum electronics, which had its birth in the blackbody spectrum of a hot object, you're able to measure the blackbody spectrum of the universe, in a sense. Right? And I find that a beautiful circle. And it also reminds us that good instruments, good measurement techniques, enable discoveries if you are careful. And let's not forget that the same very basic optical instrument, which we used to teach at high school and now it's probably at university, which is the Michelson interferometer, was used to confirm both the special and general theories of relativity. Okay? And so it's a basic instrument which has wide, wide applications. So sometimes we have to teach these instruments in our courses, and we teach them in a very abstract mathematical way, and we don't highlight the fact that they're extremely important for all sorts of things in fundamental physics. Now, the laser was invented in 1960, and in 1961, the first nonlinear effect was observed with a laser. And this was the doubling of the frequency of light. So a red laser was focused into a nonlinear crystal, and the oscillating dipoles, if you like, the oscillation frequencies of the atoms inside the crystal material, oscillated anharmonically so that the second harmonic was excited. So red light goes in and blue light comes out. Okay, in fact, this laser here, which is green, actually starts off at 1.064 microns, and its frequency doubled in a crystal just like this to become 532 nanometers. Unfortunately, the spectrographic measurement showing the frequency doubling showed a speck, only a speck here, which was removed by the editor of the American Institute of Physics, thinking that it was just a spot of dirt on the photographic plate submitted to the journal. So the very first evidence of nonlinear optics was actually removed from the publication, and we find another problem in publications later on. Now, Charles Townes, who invented the laser, noticed something rather interesting about some experimental results that he had been made aware of in another laboratory. He was told that sometimes if you focused a ruby laser inside a piece of inside a lens or in a glass, then sometimes you'd find a track, a longitudinal line of damage inside the glass. And he recognized that that was very unusual, because you would normally expect a laser beam, if it was focused like any light beam, it would be focused and then it would spread out. But something was happening inside the glass to make the laser beam travel in a straight line. It was trapping itself in a way. And he called this effect self-trapping or self-focusing. And the idea behind it is that a laser beam would normally diffract out like this. Okay? But under some circumstances, a laser can self-focus like this. And these two effects can compensate each other to create a beam that more or less will remain the same size as it propagates, a self-trapped beam called a soliton, which we'll come back to later. And the physics of this is actually rather easy to understand when you understand what a lens does, which is simply provide a different effective thickness of glass. A lens is shaped like this, so the thickness of the glass is greatest in the middle, and then it gets thinner. And what this means is that the effective optical path length is greater in the middle than at the edges. And this happens with any laser beam automatically if the laser beam has something like a Gaussian intensity profile. So if the intensity is high enough, the microscopic interaction of the laser beam with the material will locally increase the material density to create a nonlinear refractive index, which is greater in the middle than at the edges, just like a lens is thicker in the middle than at the edges. And this creates a self-induced lens or a self-induced waveguide in the material that causes this process of self-focusing. So Charles Townes recognized this. Now, in 1970, we're going slowly, but we are making progress in 1970. 70s were a great year for fashion and music, but also for laser science. So Arthur Ashkin wrote this paper about radiation pressure and the trapping of optical particles, also using the particular intensity variation of a laser beam because of its Gaussian-like profile. And there's a wonderful article in Nature Photonics in 2011, which is an interview with him. And I won't go into the details here, but this is the basic physics. The transfer of momentum from the scattering of photons in a plane transverse to a laser beam with radially varying intensity can create a potential which traps particles towards the center of the potential. If you've got 17,000 euros, you can buy the Nobel Prize kit from Thor Labs, and it can be delivered by the end of next week. So if we just use Joe's credit card, I'm sure we can order that before we go home. Now, trapping was awarded with the Nobel Prize in 1997, but Arthur Ashkin didn't get it. Okay, so three people did, also friends of UNESCO who have spoken at UNESCO events, Steve Chu, Claude Cohen-Tanucci, Bill Phillips. And it's an interesting question why he didn't get the Nobel Prize in 1997. First of all, I think quantum technologies were very fashionable at the time, they still are. So there was a desire to recognize quantum optics. There's also two Americans get the prize and one Frenchman. I think there's maybe maybe they didn't want to give the award to three Americans, okay? There was also a desire, I believe, to recognize Cohen-Tanucci not only for his great theory, but also for his great commitment to education and his pedagogy. So it's very difficult to second guess. You will be alive, and I won't be, at the time when the records are unsealed. Okay, so 50 years from 1997. Okay, I might be alive, right? But you, some of you definitely will be. So go online, look up the history of this and see if I'm right. Okay, Ashkin had to wait 21 years before he got the Nobel Prize. But Ashkin also did the first experiment following up Charles Townes' explanation of this trapping that they saw, and he made the first measurements of spatial solitons in 1974, which I think is fascinating. So he was obviously interested in trapping, whether linearly using an optical tweezers or nonlinearly in the case of a spatial soliton. Now, 1963, we go back again to when the first pulsed laser was reported. And the idea of a pulsed laser or a mode-locked laser underlies the ultrafast optics field that was recognized by the prize to Maru and Strickland. Now, the principle of a mode-locked or ultrafast laser is quite simple. Any optical cavity, like any musical instrument, has a certain finite number of standing wave modes longitudinally described along the length between the two reflecting mirrors. The frequency given by the condition that an integral number of half wavelengths have to fit into the boundary conditions of your standing wave cavity. Now, you can see intuitively that if you can construct a situation where the phases of these different modes remain fixed with time, but the modes oscillate together, so they're not oscillating independently, they're oscillated as coupled oscillators, then at certain moments of time, all the phases will, all the crests will line up, and in between these points, there'll be an essentially random, although it's not random, a zone of destructive interference. So this will give you a localized burst of energy here and here and nothing in between. Now, there's a beautiful mechanical analogy you can use to see this periodicity of coupled oscillators, and it's based on constructing an array of pendula such that the lengths vary with the square root dependence so that the frequency interval between the oscillators is constant. And it's an interesting exercise to work out what that equation is. And this lets you see this kind of behavior. So you set all the oscillators going. And it looks like there's a speed issue here, but it looks as if they are not really having any internal order, but then there are moments when you can see some order. So this looks kind of a bit chaotic, but you wait a bit longer and you start to see there's a pattern there. Chaos, seemingly, a pattern. And if you wait long enough, we'll get right back to where we were at the beginning. And then the cycle will repeat. So every time you're operating a mode-locked laser, every time your pulse comes out of the laser cavity, you're essentially recovering that initial moment, and if you like the music, that's the composer. Now, 1966 saw the first development of the optical guiding wave fiber, without which we wouldn't have modern science through CERN and data exchange, and without which we wouldn't have Game of Thrones. I'll let you decide which is the most important. But the dragons are pretty cool. So the Nobel Prize for this went to Charles Kao in 2009. So again, a long time after the discovery. And it was as a result of a curious transposition of ideas between plasma physics and optical fibers. So this is 66 when the fiber was first made. 73, so it's only 7 years afterwards, where Akira Hasegawa from the plasma physics field recognized that the nonlinear Schrodinger equation with a cubic nonlinearity could describe both dust waves or ion waves in plasmas and optical light pulses propagating in fibers. And so he extended the idea of the spatially trapped field that was discussed by Charles Towns and others into a temporally trapped field. So a pulse of light in time that would not change. So just as if you take a laser beam and you just propagate it in space, the laser beam size increases because of diffraction, the propagation of a light pulse will disperse in time to become longer. And he found a way of using nonlinearity to stop that. Now, the history of the soliton itself actually goes back centuries, a century before that. So the temporal soliton from Hasegawa and plasma physics goes back to 1973, but it has its origin in hydrodynamics, in particular, the observation that the observation here is quite curious. It begins with the early days of communication, which was actually the same as transportation, because in 1830, if you wanted to communicate information from point A to point B, you had to put the information in a letter, put the letter on a horse, and ride from point A to point B. Or you can put the letter with a human being in a bag on a boat and use a horse to tow the boat. So this is how barges would travel across Europe. And in Scotland in 1835, an observation, an empirical observation was made that depending on the speed of the horse, the boat would either sit down on the water, right, and create drag, or it would sit on top of a kind of a wave and it would surf along at a much greater speed. And this observation attracted the attention of an engineer scientist called John Scott Russell, who was at the same time developing a competing transportation technology based on steam engines along exactly the same route. So he had a commercial interest as well as a scientific one in trying to understand why boats would go fast under some circumstances and slow under others. And so he did some experiments in the Union Canal in Edinburgh, and he describes a particular day which he claimed is the happiest day of his life, when he was doing an experiment where he was using horses, more horses, this time attached to a boat. So the horses go this way, and the detail in the experimental figures at the time is quite interesting. There's even a whip on the horse, and they're wearing hats, health and safety. So the horse is going this way, and the boat's going this way. And one day during the experiment, one of the ropes in this apparatus broke, disconnecting the horses from the boat. And what he says is that the boat stopped because it was no longer connected to the horses. But the mass of water underneath the boat kept on going. And he realized this as a singular and exceptional kind of wave, which he called a large, solitary, progressive, or traveling wave. And you can make these things in a wave tank just by choosing the dimensions and the mass of water you release.
I see trees of green, red roses too.
And you can see how the form of this wave is remaining unchanged in the wave tank.
And I think to myself,
and you can imagine an 1835 scientist seeing one of these things 3 meters wide, maybe 50, 75 centimeters high, taking off. He hopped on another horse and he rode to follow it along the canal for 2 miles before it disappeared. And if you're visiting Heriot Watt University, you can, in about 20 minutes, walk from the campus to the spot where he discovered the solitary wave in 1834. So it's a wonderful walk when it's not raining, which isn't very often in Scotland. But that work also occurred about the same time that scientists were learning to solve differential equations. We never teach the history of this stuff enough. People struggle with these things. But it took 30 years before people really understood that this effect was real experimentally. And it took until 1895 before Korteweg and de Vries worked out that there was a nonlinear solution to the differential equation that described the wave that Russell had seen. Now, in nonlinear science kind of was relegated to a state of curiosity, apart from some specialists, until the Manhattan Project in the 1940s led to the development of computers. And in 1953, following up on ideas of Fermi that he had during the war but never followed up, Fermi passed an ULAM in the 1950s, did numerical experiments where they wanted to explore what would happen if you started, if you examined a system of coupled oscillators, you excited them, say, in the first normal mode of the system. What they expected was that there would be a thermodynamic equipartition of energy into all the modes of the system, and there was, but then the energy flowed back the other way. So it started off to thermalize, and then it stopped thermalizing, and it came back and it recreated its initial coherent state. So you're kind of going against the laws of physics, where entropy is increasing, and then, hang on a second, we're going back the other way, and we're reversing time, and we're coming back to recreate our initial localized state. Now, what's interesting about this, apart from the physics, is that it gives us another story, that if you look at the first paper, there's a footnote down the bottom where they say, we thank Miss Mary Tsingu for efficient coding of the problems. And that's Mary Tsingu. There was a paper in Physics Today in 2008 describing her contributions to that work. And she was left off the paper, not because she was a woman, but because she was a computer programmer, which in the grand hierarchy of things of the 1950s was even lower a status than being a woman coder, because it was considered very technical, very like being like soldering would be today, like an electrical engineering technician. We consider that as instrumentation, right? But when you look at the coding that was required, it definitely wasn't trivial. And if you've never seen this film, you definitely should, because it also shows that the work of the early computers, that is, women computers, as human beings who are computing, was underappreciated, and rightly so. It's being recognized, as is the very first scientific computation, which was also done by a woman, who was Ada Lovelace. And she worked out the first algorithm, what we would call the first algorithm for Charles Babbage's difference engine, to calculate Bernoulli numbers. And so this history of women doing great work and being unrecognized is definitely not a new one in science. Now we're going to jump right ahead. We've had solitons in nonlinear science, and we've had lasers, and now we've put them together. And in 1984, we come up with the first idea that you can create a mode-lock laser that can contain inside it a pulse of light which is so strong that it induces some nonlinearity, but the nonlinearity and the dispersion compensate each other to create a stable soliton pulse. Now, there are two names on this paper that are interesting. One is Oscar Martinez, who I'll come back to, and one is Jim Gordon, who didn't get the Nobel Prize for the maser, but he kept on working anyway. Now, the problem was that although you could take the theory from plasma physics and apply it to fiber optics and apply it to lasers to describe how the lasers could work, if you tried to make these pulse energies too high, you created exactly the same kind of damage through self-focusing that Charles Townes had tried to explain in the 1960s. So from 1960 to 1985, 20-year problem, you couldn't amplify lasers that high. And this abstract for the 1985 Nobel Prize-winning paper from Strickland and Maru sets the scene perfectly. The onset of self-focusing of intense light pulses limits the amplification. Okay? However, we have a solution to this problem coming from radar. And what we report here is a system that transposes the technique from radar into optics. Now, some of you will do PhDs. I hope a lot of you will do PhDs. And if you do, it's worthwhile reading what Donna Strickland thought about this project, because she did this as a PhD student. So Gerard Maru, in memoirs written 10 years ago, wrote, Donna was excited but concerned it might not be good enough for a PhD. Well, I think she was wrong. Right? This could also say you should listen to your supervisor, right? But maybe not all the time. Okay? What's interesting about this paper is that it was published twice. It was published in October and in December. But in October, they transposed a completely random picture of some gas chromatography setup instead of the picture of the chirp pulse amplifying system. But they, to their credit, they actually reprinted the entire paper and not just an erratum in the figure. And I think that's a fascinating piece of story because publishers have a habit of really screwing up when it comes to important results in nonlinear and ultrafast optics. Now, this is a citation record of this paper. So it's interesting. It didn't set the world on fire instantly, but very steadily and very consistently, right, the number of publications of this particular paper have increased with time, and I suspect it will increase a bit more in the coming years. Now, in 1991, chirp pulse amplification was mentioned here in this very room at a winter college in February on ultrafast phenomena, where Anthony Johnson, who's a former OSA president as well, gave a lecture on techniques of high-power amplification in ultrafast physics. So here's a photograph of the attendees of this winter college, and Oscar Martinez is there. So the A.O.E. Martinez, who was on that laser physics paper, and I am here. Right? So I was up there in 1991. Right? So don't limit yourselves and think that maybe in 27 years, right, you'll be down here. Right? Or maybe even on the wall as a director. Okay? Keep your horizons high. Now, pulses, amplification, that's easy. Pulse, we know what a pulse is. Amplification, Einstein told us about that. What is this thing called chirp? And why is chirped pulse amplification worthy of a Nobel Prize? Well, chirp is easy. So we all know what chirp is. Chirp is the variation of frequency in time. So we can have a chirp that goes up in time, okay, a song that just increases. Or we can have a very complex time frequency variation if we play the piano with two hands. Now, this is a complicated time frequency signal, but it's not a chirped signal. A chirped signal is a very special kind of linear, sometimes non-linear, increase of frequency with time. And chirp has its origin in radar, because when people first started to make long antennas in World War I, and later when they developed coastal radar in World War II, they realized that sometimes you would hear audio frequencies. You'd hear these strange signals listening to the radio when there wasn't anything. Now, this was well before they had the capability to measure the cosmic microwave background, so they knew it was coming from Earth. And where it was coming from was the atmosphere, but electromagnetic waves produced from lightning strikes in the ionosphere would create electron oscillations of a few kilohertz. We can hear a kilohertz. So we could hear an electromagnetic wave, which is a crazy thing to think about, right? So our ears become sensitive to electromagnetic radiation. And this picture here is a time frequency diagram of the frequency measured with time. So it's like a score of music, except instead of showing discrete notes, it's continuous. And this phenomena of chirp is not just limited to Earth. Any planet with an atmosphere will display this, and it was heard in Jupiter So the radio antennas of Voyager 1 in March 1979 heard chirp in Jupiter. So listen to this. This is an incredible recording. So we're listening to little electrons in the atmosphere of Jupiter oscillating in the kilohertz regime because there's some kind of electrical storm. I find this incredible stuff. Right? Now, the time frequency domain was analyzed mathematically. So people took they took the musical score and they transposed it to the mathematical. They used signal processing and so on. And this paper was published, The Theory and Design of Chirp Radars, a very important paper. And they mention here, a pictorial representation has been discussed by Gabor. Now, Gabor was a Hungarian physicist who won the Nobel Prize for holography, but he also wrote one of the most important papers on communication theory. We often associate the name of Shannon with communication, but Gabor was earlier and as equally influential. And what I love about this abstract of his paper is that he says, well, no, this isn't the abstract, this is the text. He says, let us tentatively adopt the view that time and frequency are legitimate references for describing a signal. Now, when we teach you Fourier transforms and when we teach you signal processing, we accept it as a given. We can describe a signal in time or we can describe it in frequency. And if you have a trouble understanding that, you're not intelligent enough. That's the kind of thing we say. But a Nobel Prize winner struggled with this idea when he first thought about it. So it's absolutely normal that you struggle with it too. And we don't tell you enough that that's okay. We present physics like it's mathematics, where everything is axiomatic and clean and just learn it. But it's not like that at all. It's messy, it's hard. It's hard to get your head around, and you struggle all the time. That's for the message we should be getting. Now, the Chirp Radar title of the paper also has a little footnote saying that the appellation or the label or the name Chirp was first used by a guy called B.M. Oliver in an internal memorandum in Bell Laboratories, not with a bang, but a chirp in 1951. And what he was trying to describe was that if you didn't want your radar set to blow up and go bang, you had to introduce a chirp to stretch out your radio signals before they were amplified by the vacuum tubes or the valves. And this is a very interesting play on words, not with a bang but a chirp, and it gives us a link to another Nobel Prize from T.S. Eliot, who won the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1948 for his poem, which ended, not with a bang, but a whimper, describing the end of the world. And if you look at what's happening in world politics, sometimes you just want to sit down and whimper and cry, right? And so hopefully we're not heading there yet. So this was 1925, The Hollow Men, and it was written between 1918 and 1939, right? Which is not a dissimilar political time to today. So if you've never read The Hollow Men and you are not feeling depressed, very important, you can read that and you can read a Nobel laureate in literature. So this is how it worked in radar. This is a 1980 paper which describes a radio signal at high power. You stretch it out from 5 nanoseconds to 1 millisecond, you make it longer, you conserve energy. So by making it longer, you make it less intense to conserve the area under your signal. That thing you can put into an amplifier. You won't blow up the amplifier, you'll create a long pulse, and then you come up with a technique to compress the pulse back to the way it was. Now, you may have studied radio frequency signals and a thing called Smith charts, and if you have, you'll know what I'm talking about, that you can do that. But if you haven't, then we'll just go straight to the optics and show you how a chirp pulse amplifier works. And you stretch out a pulse by using diffraction gratings or some other material that can disperse light. But What's interesting is that in a piece of material such as glass or an optical fiber, the sign of the dispersion, the way in which the refractive index changes the wave speed as a function of wavelength, is something determined by nature. But if you take two dispersive elements, like two prisms or two gratings, then you have not only the dispersion of the grating element to play with, but you also have the geometrical dispersion, which depends on the distance between the diffracting objects. And by playing with these things, you can actually change the sign of dispersion. And this allows you to stretch a pulse and to compress it. So you can take a pulse, stretch it out, amplify it to high intensity, keeping its intensity below the point where you'll damage the amplifier, and then recompress it at the end. So your amplified pulse here, if you tried to create a pulse like that by amplifying this pulse here, you would destroy this amplifier. But you increase the energy in the same proportion, but keeping the peak intensity below the damage threshold. Why is this worth a Nobel Prize? Because without this technique, the intensity from lasers, which increased fairly steadily as the first lasers were made, they invented mode locking in 1963, then it kind of trailed off, and it was more or less heading for saturation, remembering that this is a log scale. And once CPA was invented, orders of magnitude increase. And with that, you can do all these things. High-intensity lasers in medicine, laser plasma, laser wake field acceleration, all these buzzwords of modern physics, attoseconds, and so on. Now, the extreme light infrastructure is a three-country European Commission-supported initiative to create very large lasers based on CPA to do nuclear physics, high-field physics, and maybe even tabletop cosmology by making field strengths in the focus of a laser beam comparable to those that you can get in by smashing particles together at CERN through the techniques used in particle acceleration. And UNESCO has opened a Category 2 institute in Romania precisely to train scientists in the theoretical aspects and some maybe the experimental aspects of this field. So it's a very topical area, not only for ICTP and CERN and UNESCO, but also for science in general. This is a letter that you get when you're asked to nominate people for the Nobel Prize. And it says a couple of things, so it's worthwhile knowing about this. First of all, a valid nomination has to be submitted every year. So in other words, there is no memory in the system of the Nobel Prize. So if you were ranked number 2 in 2016 and everyone thought you were a sure thing, so and no one remembered to nominate you in 2017, you wouldn't get it. Right? And the other interesting thing about it is that the terms of the prize differ between the disciplines. So in physics, it's a discovery or invention. In chemistry, it's a discovery or improvement. Now that's interesting, okay? And so on, okay? It's ideally, it should be ideally in the initial formulation, it was for work done in the last 12 months that has now been extended to saying that older work can be acknowledged if the significance has been appreciated recently. So back to Donna Strickland, here's her PhD thesis. What is very interesting about this, of course, all we read is the acknowledgements, right? And it's worthwhile reading the fact that not only did her thesis involve developing the source of CPA, and also did the first application in high field science. And I think that's extremely important. Other things about the Nobel Prize that are interesting, this time lag is increasing. So this is a paper from 2014, which basically traces the year in which the Nobel Prize was awarded and the number of years since the discovery was actually made. So Nobel Prizes in the 1920s were made for work done in 1910. Nobel Prizes in 2010 were made for work done in the 1990s. So it's 20, 30 years. So CPA, we're kind of above 30 years, at LED, 26 years. For the LIGO and the Higgs Prize, it's kind of interesting because the prize was awarded 1 or 2 years after the discoveries experimentally, but the theory and the foundations and the construction of the infrastructure necessary to do that was done 50 years before. So I don't know where to put these plots, those prizes on this graph. Now, Nobel laureates, you think they have an easy life, but they this is interesting. This is a clip from the winner of the Nobel Prize in Physiology of Medicine in 2009, talking about an experience she had on the day she won the Nobel Prize. Now, the sound is a bit low, but it has captions running across, so maybe you can hear it. Worthwhile listening to.
On October 5th, 2009, the grant proposal that I sent in 5 months before was to be discussed at a meeting of 20 of my peers at the NIH study section. The reviewers had written their reviews before the meeting. At 5:15 that morning, I received a phone call from the Nobel Committee saying that I would share the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine with Liz Blackburn and Jack Szostak for the discovery of telomerase. The press barrage began around 5:45. It was all over the news. My scientific colleagues knew first thing that morning. The Grant Review Committee convened at 8 a.m. And when my grant came up, it was triaged. That is, it was deemed not worthy for discussion. I will read to you from the summary statement. This is a clearly written proposal that describes work to induce telomerase to treat disease. Weaknesses. The only major weakness is the limited preliminary data presented in support of the aims. So even on the day when you win the Nobel Prize, skeptics may question whether you really know what you're doing.
And that's a very important lesson for everyone, especially for students who come up, and you're going to have to live with this for the rest of your career. I hope that you'll be actively involved in seeking funding for all your work. Now, this is 50 minutes, so there's a time to stop here and conclude, or I can go on for another five. Okay, so just go very quickly now. In 1991, so I was motivated in, I met Oscar Martinez and Tony Johnson here in Trieste in 1991. And they told me to go and work in St. Andrews in Scotland, because in Scotland, they had just discovered a way of making pulsed lasers out of solid-state crystals with broad bandwidth. So this discovery was as important to ultrafast science as CPA was from the development of sources. And for many years, people were thinking that this gentleman here would share a Nobel Prize with Gerard Mourou. And maybe he will in the future, but that's a different question altogether. This particular laser combines together temporal solitons to compress the pulse in time and spatial solitons to stabilize the oscillation. If you inject one of these lasers into an optical fiber, you generate a white light continuum, a spectrum that covers a rainbow but with 100,000 times more intensity than sunlight at the output of the fiber. And this is a Finnish student who's clearly not really obeying safety regulations, but it's a great photograph. Now, this discovery and the sensitivity of this highly nonlinear process to noise allowed you to feed back and to stabilize the laser itself and to take these modes, these cavity modes, that are locked in phase to a precision that allowed you to measure frequencies to 1 part in 10 to the 15 through a technique called optical frequency metrology. And that led to another Nobel Prize in 2005. And I'll let you look up the details of how that works. And I was involved in the early 2000s. I was supposed to know about fiber optics, and I was supposed to know about femtosecond lasers because I'd worked in the early days at St. Andrews. And so I was asked to try to explain why some experiments created very stable Nobel Prize-winning rainbow supercontinua, and others created a noisy mess. And so I did some numerical modeling, again using techniques from plasma physics and elsewhere, and just did some simulations in MATLAB, very simple things, where I showed that noise could create this tremendously chaotic system where sometimes the spectra would have a certain bandwidth and sometimes it wouldn't, but you could create a situation where it would be stable. And if you did, you would make a stable thing. And this was extended by some other researchers in UCLA to claim that the statistics of the noise reflected the same statistics that ocean waves had. So these giant rogue waves that sink ships because they are 30 meters high and come out of nowhere, the proposal in this paper in Nature was that if you measure the statistics of the supercontinuum's instabilities, you found the same kind of very long tail with rare events that you found in ocean waves. And this opened up a whole new field, and we worked out the mathematical equivalence, showing that the same nonlinear Schrodinger equation that describes waves on the deep water also describes light pulse envelopes and fibers. And the first place it was used was in plasma physics by Hasegawa and others, and by Zakharov in Russia even before that. And this interest in the multidisciplinary applications of studying what is a very fairly relatively simple system led us to really develop new measurement techniques. And this is what I've done for the last 10 years in the lab, making measurements. This is a bit technical, so I won't go into too much detail, but essentially you can measure spectral fluctuations now in real time at megahertz or gigahertz repetition rate. So in the early 20th century, if you wanted to measure a blackbody spectrum, you would have your emitter, you would take a source, you would wait for 10 minutes for the system to integrate the intensity at each wavelength and give you a spectrum. Now you can measure a spectrum from a single pulse from a laser operating at 1 gigahertz. And you can measure sequentially what the spectra are doing from shot to shot. So you can measure statistics and optical rogue waves. You can do the same thing in time by using dispersion and an equivalent of a temporal lens to stretch a pulse. And if you combine these things together, you can take pictures like this, which were taken in 1963, showing the very first behavior of a mode-lock laser, and you can watch the birth of a laser. So these are experiments just done last year and published this year, where you combine the time lens and the real-time spectra, and you turn a laser on. So we actually have a key of the laser. Turn it on. And then you can watch over 100 trips in the cavity. Right? Each trip's taking 20 nanoseconds. And you can watch the pulses build up on picosecond timescales. And sometimes they just die. And you won't get a burst for another millisecond. And then all of a sudden, the laser will become stable. And we can look inside the very birth of lasers on a classical sense and see how these instabilities are developing. And so the state of the art in this field now is really the measurement techniques. We're not actually doing anything different from that, but we're doing it on much faster timescales on a single shot basis, and we're plotting the results in color so they look nicer. So this is a conclusion. Actually, before I conclude, let me just thank all the students I've worked with in that work going back 10 years or so on the results I showed. But let me just conclude with this statement, that ultrafast optics is much more than just doing things really fast. It enables all sorts of things in all sorts of fields, from material processing to fundamental science. And the real question is there another Nobel Prize for ultrafast-related science? There was one in 1997 in femtochemistry to Ahmed Zewail. So there was one in 2018. So where would it be? So atto science is an interesting one. Right? Actually looking on 10 to the minus 18 of a second timescales. Is there new physics? And there's fascinating work being done in Zurich by a scientist called Ursula Keller, who's looking at questioning the very fundamental assumptions of quantum mechanics. One, for example, is we say tunneling, quantum tunneling, instantaneous. Right? Instantaneous is just a theorist's word for saying we don't know how to solve it if it's not, right? So let's assume it's instantaneous, okay? So she's trying to determine, is tunneling instantaneous? How fast do I have to be able to measure before I will see the non-instantaneous nature of something like quantum tunneling? Fascinating questions. So personally, I think that if that question is answered, that might be the next one. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. That was really delightful. Any questions?
I've read that if you are at the end of a seminar and you say, are there any questions, right, you get a certain number of responses, say X.
Yes.
Okay? Now, if you turn the question around and say, well, someone from this row asked me a question, then you get five times more responses.
Oh, really?
Right?
And
so,
from that row?
Well, we'll see. So this row here, a question, please.
Yes. Actually, I'm in this row. Who was the gentleman in St. Andrews that you had the photo of?
Okay, so this is the last author on that paper was Wilson Sibbett. Here. So that's this gentleman here.
Oh, okay. Right?
The difficulty with that is because the difficulty with an award for the Nobel Prize for the femtosecond source is because there were a lot more than three people involved, right? And work was being done in industry labs as well as in academic labs. And when it was first invented, it was not understood whatsoever. But, you know, the Nobel Prize is for invention or discovery in physics, right? Which is why I think it went to CPA and why it went to Donna Strickland. It's not a career or lifetime achievement award. So there are lots of people who have done a career-long corpus of science using CPA. Now, that's not the point of the prize. And the discovery was that the practical implementation, the invention, was by Donna Strickland, under the direction of Gerard Maru. So even though there are discussions saying that it should have gone to people who'd worked for more years, that's not right. The terms of the prize are very, very clear. Invention works.
Quite funny question about the Nobel leg. For physics, there was two Nobel Prize, which was very, very fast. For example, for high temperature superconductivity, then for carbon nanostructures. So maybe this graph is not so precise, is it, or I wrong understand?
Well, we would have to look into the details of what the prize text may say. Right? So from our point of view, if you take high TC, I don't know the details. So there are two possibilities. Either the graph is wrong or it's not wrong. And we'd have to look at what the citation itself referred to. And this may not be what our perception refers to, because very often, in order to identify the maximum of three individuals who share the prize, you have to dig into the history to find out who had the original idea first. And so that original idea may have been earlier than what we consider to be recent. So we'd have to look at it.
I'm sitting in the wrong row, but I hope I may nevertheless ask a question. So you focused very much on the very fast and the super and ultra fast. Can you give us kind of a perspective also on the small side? Because, I mean, when I was at school, I learned that the wavelength of light is determining what you can observe as the smallest thing, and then obviously scientists managed to observe even the smaller things with light. So what is your perspective on what will come in the future on what we can observe on the small length scale with lasers?
Well, so if you're referring to the 2014 Nobel Prize for Super Resolution, then I don't know if it's coincidence, you know, but 2015 was known it was going to be a year of light, okay? 2015, sorry, was known that it was going to be a year of light. And one of the people who was involved in the early days of the formation of the year of light in 2015 was Sunny Swanberg, who was a former past chair of the Nobel Physics Committee. And in 2014, we had a Nobel Prize in physics for the white LED and chemistry for super resolution. And I can't believe that's a coincidence. I think maybe the Nobel Committee was consciously or otherwise trying to help us out to spread the message of the importance of light in science. So if they did, then they did the right thing. Now, super resolution, I think, fits under the idea of improvement in the charter of the Nobel Prize in chemistry, right? Because it's a discovery or improvement. So I think that's an interesting way to think about that particular award. I don't work for the Nobel Committee. I just speculate like anyone, okay? So I have no knowledge, and no one knows what goes on behind the doors. It's like a big inverse problem where you're trying to figure out what's going on inside the box by looking at the little tunneling that comes out. And so coming back to the question of how small spatially we can go, well, the transverse section of any optical field is ultimately determined by the wavelength of light. So there's an uncertainty relationship between confinement and angular spread. So you can't focus infinitely. You can't get to that geometrical optics regime on a finite bench. But the tricks you can play are things like having a nonlinear response of the interaction. So one technique that's used is by, if you have a beam, for example, that has a profile like this, this dimension here, the width of it is determined by the wavelength. But if you have a nonlinear process whose threshold may start here, then you're only sampling that little fraction of the transverse profile. And that can give you the sub-wavelength resolution. So, for example, in my own lab, we do this technique where we use Bessel beams, which are kind of like an extended Gaussian beam. You combine across two beams, and there's a lobe in the middle that has a one-wavelength transverse extent. But you focus it at millijoule energies, thanks to CPA, but you adjust it so that the intensity of the material, the ablation process, only occurs over lambda over 10 or lambda over 4 of the transverse extent. And so you can make holes in material of 100 or 200 nanometers in size, which I think is really interesting. Or you can go to short wavelengths, which is what they do in lithography. So these computers that we buy today have a 50 nanometer structure size, transistor size. So what's the limit? I don't know, right? I know the limit we'd like to get to, and that would be the Planck length, but this is, I don't think we'll do that with tabletop lasers. So maybe holography can help, right? Because holography is if you look at something like a Michelson interferometer and you stabilize it, then you can measure fringe displacements of lambda over 1,000. Even in a lambda over 100 is a laboratory experiment. So the wavelength isn't a limitation if you can also measure the phase. So I don't know.
I would like to hear your opinion about the fact related with the Nobel Prize given to Stephen Chu in 1997 due to the laser cooling. Even though he was a student of Asking during that time, they were working in the same lab, and Asking was not considering for the Nobel Prize during that time, and right now was...
Well, okay, so what... So I heard Stephen Chu when I was doing my PhD. I heard him give a talk in 1990 or 1989 in Australia at Macquarie University, actually, in a summer school. And he made no secret of the fact that they were creating this thing called optical molasses. So this is a term they no one uses that term anymore, but that was what it was called at the time, to create this dense state. And even at the time, it was recognized that there was an injustice in not awarding that prize to Arthur Ashkin. But the Nobel Prize in the 1990s, if you look at the history, they did move away from the original intention of the prize charter, and they tended to award career achievements. So they tended to award an extended body of work. Now, they also moved away from Nobel's intention to award inventions, and they focused on big physics. So big physics is quantum physics, quantum optics, okay? And that's beautiful stuff. Quantum optics was a burgeoning field in the 1980s and 1990s. And after this prize, there was also the Bose-Einstein condensate. That was actually a very quick prize as well, the BEC, right? Which is another thing to look at, plotting that lag graph. But Arthur Ashkin, maybe the wording here is wrong. Okay, for development of methods to cool and trap atoms with laser light, because it was clear that Ashkin developed the technique. So Ashkin developed the technique for trapping particles, but the cooling techniques in terms of using the recoil, the Doppler detuned and the Sisyphus cooling technique and so forth, that was developed by these three. Ashkin never did the quantum optics with this. Right? But it was something, it was an injustice, I think, and people recognize that. On the other hand, it recognized as a student, right? Whereas Jim Gordon had been neglected from the award of the Mason, okay? And the other classic example is Jocelyn Bell Burnell, who missed out on the 1974 Nobel Prize because she did the measurements of pulsars with radio telescopes, but it was her supervisor who got the prize. And then there very clearly was a bias against the student and against the fact that she was a woman scientist back in 1974. So I think maybe the consciously or unconsciously, maybe there's no point in the discussion, but whatever the reason, the award to Maru and Strickland is a perfect answer to these things. Student and supervisor. And you address retrospectively the neglect of Jocelyn Bell Burnell, and hopefully the future now will progress in a similar way where we can put all these silly discussions behind us about gender issues and it's not a silly discussion, but we can put these issues aside and just focus on who did the science, who deserves the award, who made the discovery, and just say it doesn't matter if it's a student, doesn't matter where they're from, doesn't matter, just focus on the science. I hope.
Thank you for your wonderful presentation. So I have a question about the coherence of the light of the supercontinuum. I read your books and some paper like optics later, and you focus on the intra-pulse coherent and inter-pulse coherent. What is the difference? Why you focus on the only in the intra-pulse coherent light source?
Okay, so this is kind of a technical question, but it's an interesting one because it it touches on the fundamental properties of light. So coherent light is one where you have this fixed phase relationship. Now, when you have a supercontinuum, you have all these different modes of the cavity, of your laser cavity, and even though you see a supercontinuum, underneath that continuum is actually a discrete line or comb of frequencies. And what you want to know is whether these things are a million different lasers all phase locked together, okay? Whether their intensity and whether their phase is constant. So the great thing about a supercontinuum is that it's kind of a universal laser. It's spatially coherent because it's generated in an optical fiber. And if it's going to be a universal laser where you can select any one of these lines in any color and turn it into a laser with high power, then you need to focus on what the coherence of these things are. And for it to be a laser, a coherent in a laser sense, every single pulse that generates the continuum has to generate an identical continuum. And a corollary, I think, or maybe it's a hypothesis associated with that, it's one or the other, right, is that the coherence both from pulse to pulse, the phase stability from pulse to pulse, and also within each pulse has to be very, very high, or has to be perfect. So that's why we focus on that question. And if you want a more technical answer, we can talk afterwards. We've had no questions from over here. We have to have one, at least. Otherwise, we're breaking symmetry, and the universe will explode. Okay. Who knows? Right? I mean, it's like the timescale for laser fusion. It's always 50 years from today, right? I really don't know. I think certainly it's going to be shorter now that the Nobel Prize was awarded for CPA than it would have been otherwise, because there's a lot of political advantage in being associated with a recent Nobel laureate. And so I think that Gerard Mourou's funding applications for ELI-related science will be funded now, whereas they wouldn't have been 5 weeks ago, which is a remarkable thing in itself. But I really don't know. But the idea here is that there are theories of very fundamental questions in cosmology and vacuum pair production from electromagnetic fields and so on that are related and which require the high energies and intensities of this huge infrastructure. And I think you're looking at, just if you look back at if history is any guide, then, the first experiments are just planned, so I think you're looking at one or two decades, I would say.
Okay. Everyone's welcome to drinks and to have nibbles outside.
Except us.
Except the diploma students. You know, you're not going anywhere. And John, who's got to stay. Let's please thank John for this wonderful presentation.